Welcome to War Gaming Recon. I am your host, Jonathan J. Reinhardt. War Gaming Recon is the only member of the TSR Podcast Network to discuss historical and New England gaming. This is episode 175, Trilaterum Games with Timothy Kalana. So I want to welcome all of you new and longtime listeners alike to this episode of War Gaming Recon. You're in for a treat because not only, as the name of the episode suggests, do we have a special guest, but I will be joined by my buddy and fellow co-host Mike Payne. Before I bring both of them on to talk with you, because you don't want to hear me, you hear me all the time, I want to remind you of something. So we're going to cover a lot of things in this episode. There's just going to be so many things we're going to throw at you, and you're going to be like, whoa, how do I keep up to it? And it's hard, right? Because you listen when you're painting your models, you're assembling stuff, you're creating your games, or if I wasn't talking to a bunch of war gamers, I would say you're at the gym, although some of you probably are, but if you see me in person, you know I'm not a gym rat, so I know that doesn't happen, but you're commuting and so forth. The point is, you're not sitting at your computer like, oh, I gotta see what they're saying on War Gaming Recon for me to look it up, and nobody does that. So you don't have to worry, because we have show notes. So the link to the show notes is the one thing you should remember, and that is wargamingrecon.com/WR175, wargamingrecon.com/WR175, and that'll have links to all the things we talk about, and it'll have content and other cool stuff, and it's really the only thing you need to worry about remembering, so you can just sit back and enjoy the conversation from this episode. So let me bring on my buddy and co-host Mike Payne. Mike, how are you today?
I'm good, Jonathan. How's yourself?
I'm doing okay. I'm really excited for our episode today because this is another one where our guest is a result of me saying, hey, Mike, you know a lot of people. Who do you think we should have on the show? And you said, hey, we should get this Timothy guy on. And I was like, okay, let's do it.
Yeah, give him a chance to plug his game. It looks pretty cool to me.
Well, I know you and I, we talked about it back when we were talking about the Hobby Bunker Game Day.
Right.
And I was like, there's this game next to the table that I'm playing at Mike Payne's game, and I got it all wrong. And so I'm not happy I got it wrong, but I'm happy that because of that, Timothy can come on and he can explain it and be like, Jonathan, you messed up. And you know, I mess up and I own up to it and I want to get it right. And so the game looked fantastic, and I'm excited that we'll be able to find out more about it and that listeners can be able to learn more about this game and see what's going on and that they can obtain it and play it and do all sorts of cool stuff. So why don't we bring our special guest on? Timothy, how are you today?
Hi, how are you?
I'm very happy that you are here with us on this episode of Wargaming Recon.
Well, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
So I don't know about you, but where I'm at down here, I got a bunch of snow falling outside, and it's kind of nice to be inside doing a recording, because if I wasn't here with you and with Mike, I'd have to be outside shoveling. So it gives me a respite.
Well, yes, me too. It started snowing here a little while ago, so I'm sure that after this, I'll be going outside to work on the driveway. So,
likewise, that the front walk, and I'm grateful I'm on a side street, but in my town, they use it as kind of a cut through because it loops around. So they're always going up and they plow our street. And like, I don't have to worry about like taking care of like the edge of my driveway because they do it. And when they salt, the salt gets up onto my walkway in the driveway, and it's a little less for me to do. It's kind of nice.
Nice, nice.
But we're not here to talk about the snow that I'm having, you're having, or Mike, I think you got some snow going on up there too. We're here to talk about a cool.
I do, but I'm not shoveling nothing right now.
Now, is that because like you just figure it's gonna melt, or is that because you're like, you know what, I have better things to do?
Well, I'm gonna wait for it to be done.
Okay.
You know, so, and then
yeah, you wait for it to be done.
Right, and if I wait long enough, my son will volunteer and go out there and do a whole bunch, and I'll only have to do a little.
Labor. I like the way you think. I used to be one of those.
He's a good kid. He just goes out there and does it.
Well, I used to wait until it was done, and then I got a little one, and of course, she was born in February. She's going to be 2 this February. So when she was born, that's the year we got like a ton of snow, and I'm like, I can't wait for it to stop snowing, because then it'll be like 8 feet tall, and I won't be able to shovel anything. So now I've gotten in the habit of, well, I guess I should go out and like shovel. Even though there's an inch, I'll shovel it. I'll go back in 45 minutes and shovel another inch, and it's probably stupid, but it's just, I don't want to get stuck in again like I did that one year.
Yeah, I'm not doing it that way. No way.
So why don't we talk?
I like to keep up with it, but I won't, you know, volunteer to go out. So
no way. Something fun. So let's talk about the games.
Yeah.
Let's get that out of it.
Well, because see, like on a snowy day or a sunny day or any other kind of weather, you could, instead of going outside, because who wants to go outside and experience the world? You can stay inside and have more fun by playing Trilaterum games. So, Timothy,
absolutely.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about it? Because I know it's a 15-millimeter scale miniatures sci-fi company-level war game, and I got to see a little bit in action, and that's where my knowledge ends. So tons you can teach us, I'm sure.
Sure. So Trilaterum is, as you said, a 15-millimeter scale sci-fi miniatures game. It was written to support really any miniatures lines, but specifically I wrote it for a friend of mine's line of figures by the name of Stan Johansson Miniatures. He has a 15-millimeter line of figures called Star Armor. And I originally wrote it because he had the figures and really nothing to do with them. There was no specific games for them. As well as I have quite a bit of 15-millimeter sci-fi in my collection. And I wanted something to play them with. I never really found a game that I really liked. So I wrote my own. It's, as you said, 15-millimeter company scale. All the units are multi-based, so you'll have a single base with a number of miniatures on it, and each base represents a squad of soldiers. And then each individual vehicle it represents one vehicle as well. So it's not like one vehicle represents 10 or anything like that. The game was written over a period of about 2 years. I started initially just jotting down notes and thoughts about how I really wanted the game to flow. And I came up with what I consider to be my signature mechanic in the game, which is the rapid fire system during combat. And I kind of came up with that first and then wrote the rest of the game kind of around that. And like I said, it's designed with army lists specifically for Stan's miniatures, as well as numerous other armies that you can play, as well as a full army building system. So you can really play with any miniature you have. The sky's the limit. You can use the calculation system to make whatever you want. It's fun. It's fast play. You roll a lot of dice and you have a lot of fun.
So could you have a campaign, let's say, with a bunch of different factions, different players having different factions from different universes or whatever?
Sure. It'd be actually really easy to do. You could do a map-based campaign. You could do a mission-based campaign. You could do it via either points with certain areas as you capture them would unlock you could unlock special army choices. You could unlock upgrades to the units. It's very flexible. When I wrote the book, I included six scenarios. Excuse me, six or eight. Let me look real quick. I can't remember now off the top of my head.
I can't remember crap, so you're doing okay.
Yeah. There's six scenarios right off the bat in the book. Nice. And then you could expand on that, you know, exponentially. And yeah, so you could easily run a nice long campaign, having different factions and all those sorts of things. Yeah.
How many factions are in the rule book?
The rule book currently has there's the three factions that Stan had, which is we call them the UEL, the Unified Exploration League. Those are the humans. We have the Glorious Draconid Empire, which are kind of lizard men. And then you have the Den of the Barad, which are anthropomorphic bear men. And then some of the other units or the other armies that I wrote into the book is the Legion of Ilios. They're a robotic race. And then the Parisi, which is a race of mercenaries with that encompasses many, many, many different worlds. So each unit looks vastly different because they're different alien species. So
cool. That's cool.
So, yeah. So there's five. There's five currently in the book.
Right, and I suppose I could make something up on my own if I had more players that wanted to play in the campaign or something along those lines.
Oh, you definitely can. The after the army lists in the book, there's a page that shows you exactly how I calculated points for all the units, and
nice.
You just kind of use that formula and you can make whatever you want. I've actually just started working on, and this will be a exclusive for you guys. The first supplement for the book is going to be called Trilaterum Colossals, and that will feature super heavies. So it will be large, large walkers, large land crawlers, hovercraft, something that's bigger than just your standard tank. And kind of the way that I like to think of it is you remember the old ogre game?
Sure.
Think of those kind of giant machines of war. And the goal of the system, the goal of the expansion will be that one person would field the Colossal with a few units along with it, and the other person would have a full army, and it'd be some sort of a trying to take down the Colossal sort of thing. So that's kind of on the horizon, so to speak. I've just started penning, looking at how I'm going to do the rules for the large units. So
you touched on this briefly when you were explaining a little bit about the impetus behind the rules, but when you chose to write the rules, what made you really decide to do like 15 millimeter or sci-fi even? Was it strictly, I got a friend who has these really nice models and I would love to be able to create something that people could use his models for? Or was it more of a, I want to write a set of rules and what am I actually with?
Well, I've been obviously a miniature player and a war gamer for more years than I can count nowadays. I'm sure Mike can attest himself. I've always liked sci-fi. Sci-fi has always really been my go-to genre. I like historical, I like fantasy, but sci-fi really calls to me more than anything else, really. I just love sci-fi, and one of the things that I wanted to do was create something that I could kind of channel that love for sci-fi and make some really interesting units, as well as make things that are like your core, Marines and things that are that humanity would have out there, when we get to the stars, the defense forces and that sort of thing, as well as crazy aliens and multi-limbed terrors that are coming out of the dark as your colony is being set up. Because really the fluff behind the game is humanity has really started to reach to the stars and started to colonize other worlds. And as they've colonized other worlds, typical humanity, they drop down on the world and say, okay, this is ours, the people that live there, they probably don't like that. So they're starting to bump into mainly the Draconid, who are they're the driving enemy in the narrative of the game. Being a reptilious species, they're cold-blooded, and they say anything that's not them as a something that needs to be destroyed. So as humanity has kind of come that way, they've bumped into them, and it's not looking very good as too far as the Draconids accepting them into their space. So by writing that fluff, it's kind of like me channeling some of the really interesting sci-fi stories that I've read and movies that I've watched over the years. And so it kind of so happened that as I was going through this process, you know, I saw the opportunity of utilizing a line of miniatures that was in need of a set of rules. So that was kind of a helpful piece to it. But I would say the driving force was just my passion for sci-fi.
Yeah, the nice thing about sci-fi is it's so open-ended. There's really you can go all over the place with that stuff.
And that's what I love about it. You know, there's just so much of an opportunity to utilize your imagination.
Well, and it's nice too to see something. I mean, I think when a lot of people think of sci-fi, they think of certain sci-fi properties. And so it's nice to have something that's different, that doesn't have it isn't burdened by all that history of a certain other sci-fi property, so that you have this, so that it encourages players to really just kind of be like, okay, I don't have to worry about what so-and-so would have done in such and such movie or book or whatever. Like, I can just do this because I want to try it and I've never done it before and it sounds cool and let me do it on the table and I'll move my unit here and see what this happens and see what that does to the whole fluff of the universe that is being created through the games.
No, I totally agree. As I was writing the book, my wife actually helped by writing some of the fluff for the book. And it was interesting as we talked about the universe and the fluff, and I used the fluff that we wrote to develop the scenarios in some of the army lists. And in particular, one of the stories that she wrote is about one of the colonists' children. You know, they wander into a cave, and in the cave they find these what look like to us would be teddy bears, but when in reality they're religious objects of the Barad, which are these anthropomorphic bears. So the children grab the teddy bear, goes out, you know, the little girl thinks she's found a great toy, when in reality she's just desecrated a holy spot, you know. So then as she wrote that story, I then created a scenario that ties directly into that story. So you're right, you were able to take just this really random thing that could have happened that was a great story and turn it into part of your miniature game, you know. So
you can be a little more freewheeling when you're doing something sci-fi, whereas if it was historical, there are some kind of limits anyway. I mean, I love historical.
You're constrained.
Sure.
Well, Mike, I think you have that too with your Hang High game, because you're doing pulp. Of course, it's grounded in a fair bit of history, but because it's pulp, you have that extra freedom to just be like, I'm going to do whatever the heck I want because it's going
to
be.
Yeah, I think that's what drew me to it.
I could see that.
And it sounds like Tim's kind of on the same page in his genre too. It's, you know, something that you can, you know, you can play around with and do different things with. It's cool.
Definitely. Definitely.
Timothy, why don't you walk us through some of the design process? So you've talked about, like, you have the idea and there's these models and you want to create a set of rules for it. So where do you go from that point? And like, then how do you end up, like, obviously you have to write the rules. There's probably some sort of play testing involved. You need a name for it. Why do you just kind of...
Sure. I'll go through the whole
process. Where'd you come up with the name before you go anywhere? How did you come up with that name and what does it mean?
Well, it's a Latin word for three, and what I ended up doing is because there was three races that Stan had developed, I wanted something that signified the three. So that's kind of where I came up with the name, and it just kind of stuck. I wanted something that was a little bit different, that wasn't, you know, Battles in Space or something like that. You know, I wanted something that was kind of. Would when people saw it, they would go, oh, that's a neat name. How'd you come up with that? Or, oh, that's odd. Let me look that up or something like that. So that's kind of where I came up with the name.
Okay.
But to get back to your question, Jonathan, what I started out with, as I said earlier, is I came up with this idea of I call it the rapid fire system, and that's how combat works. So in a nutshell, when you roll to fire weapons in the game uses D8s. And so anything, any hits that you score, you keep rolling. and you keep rolling until you roll some ones. And then when you roll some ones, you have to roll on this rapid fire chart. And it's a 50-50 chance of being something really great or being something absolutely horrible, such as the whole unit is destroyed. So I kind of like that little chart because it makes people have to say to themselves, do I want to keep going, or do it get kind of like a gambling aspect? You know, But in playtesting, you could definitely tell the impulsive personalities were like, oh, yeah, keep it rolling. It was like they were at the craps table or something.
Yeah, you know? I like that idea. And, that's cool.
So, and sometimes people would stop, but a lot of people like just rolling lots of dice and keeping it rolling. And then all of a sudden, oh, they rolled the one, and oh, friendly fire, I've just shot up the unit next to me. You know, it's a fun little mechanic at the, especially at the, when I'm running big games at the cons, because you get that whole excitement of rolling, and then what happens, you know, next kind of thing.
I shouldn't have rolled it that one more time.
Exactly. Oh, what? That, yeah. No, do I go one more time?
What did I do that for? Do I
stop kind of thing. And, so I wrote that.
That's cool.
I liked that. I spent a long time just sitting at tables and either hand rolling dice or using a dice simulator to simulate the dice rolling where things would land. And that's also kind of where I landed on D8s, is I wanted a little bit more variety than what a D6 will offer. So that's why I kind of gravitated towards a bigger die, that sort of thing. So after I kind of cemented that piece, then I started to work on the turn sequence and how the turn would go. I settled on an alternating activation. So each person during their turn will activate up to 3 units and then play passes to the other player. And that continues until all the units on the table have been activated. Once all the units on the table are activated, you end your turn sequence. You do any end of turn bookkeeping that needs to be done, and then you start the next turn. So once I cemented out the turn sequence, then I started working on how movement would work, how things like terrain would work, how line of sight would work. A lot of play testing, a lot of games, a lot of, again, you know, just sitting down and rolling dice and seeing how they work to determine, okay, this you know, this works well, this doesn't work well. You know, do I want to have people have to roll to see whether they can make it through cover? Do I want to just make it a flat penalty? Do I want to make it a random amount of distance for charges? I mean, all of those things that exist in various forms in different games, you kind of look at and you know, determine whether they're going to work with the systems you already have in place. Once that was done, I started the actual playtesting phase and basically went down to my local shops and ran games with friends, ran games with family, ran games with my kids. And as I got feedback from that, I massaged the rules some. Then I went and started doing some con games. So I hit Huzzah, I hit Havoc last year, Fallen, and just ran some con games to see how well it would work in a con setting. Because when you're writing a game for 2 players is a lot different than writing a game for 8 to 10 to 12 players that you would run at a con. So I had to figure out what would work and what wouldn't, and how I would modify the rules when I went to conventions to run them for multiple players. It's written to be a 2-player system, but I've been able to massage the rules so that you can run it in a con setting and have it work really well. I'm happy with where I'm at on that. It took a little bit of time to get that to work, because being as it was mainly written for 2 players, it tended to slog down and be slow when you had 8 people standing at a table. But by accelerating the turn sequence a little bit when there's multiple players, that really worked well. So the last game that I ran at Fall In, it was an excellent game. I had six players at the table. We finished the game within our time slot. Everybody had fun. A couple of guys bought a book. It was just a really good show for me. I was very happy. But yeah, that's kind of the road that I took, and along the road, I had a lot of help from some of my friends and some industry professionals that I know, looking over things and giving me tips and ideas on where to go with different things. But it's a long road and it takes a lot of work. And if I had it to do it over again, I would definitely do it again, but I wouldn't recommend that anybody who doesn't want to do a lot of work, this is probably not the road you want to take, because
yeah, you really have to have a passion for what you're doing to put that kind of work in. Because if you're not really in love with the idea of what you're doing, you're wasting your time.
Would you have
you definitely are.
Suggestions for things? Let's pretend I want to make my own game, okay. Which I don't, but let's pretend I do. Do you have any suggestions for things that I really should do or that I should avoid, like the plague? From your experience?
Let me think for a second here. I would say, take every bit of feedback that someone gives you. Both you want to listen to it, but you also want to take it with a grain of salt. You know, you can't incorporate everyone's ideas when you're writing your system. You got to kind of stick to your guns a little bit. When you come up with your idea and you get it down and you start your play testing, you have to be willing to change things. But at the same time, you've got to look at things and say, is it really worth changing that? Or is this just one guy that wasn't having a good time? I had one player, for example, in one of my games that just really didn't like the way line of sight was. And I listened to his feedback and I thought about it a real lot and I started to look at changing it. And then at the end of the day, I said, well, this is the only person that's really complained about this. I like how line of sight works. Everybody else seems to like it and doesn't have a problem with it. So maybe I should just stick with what I did. And I did, you know. And
can we examine that? What did he not like and how does it work?
Sure. So line of sight in the game is pretty much, if you could see any part of the stand, you can shoot at it. If you can't see more than 50% of the stand, there's a penalty. And what the person wanted was he wanted to incorporate two things. One was he wanted levels in the terrain to affect line of sight. And I don't really have levels in the terrain. There's either a piece of terrain or there's not a piece of terrain. And then he didn't think that if you could only see somebody's head that you should be able to shoot at it. And I said, well, you know, if you could see any part of the stand, you could shoot at it. And that was kind of what he didn't like. So I kind of looked at, well, maybe we could do if you can only see, you know, 10% or 25% of the, but it got too weedy. It got too much where you would have to make so many, oh, well, I could see 37% of that guy. You like, can I shoot at him? You know, make that call, you know?
Yeah. He was wrong. I don't agree with him at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, if you can see it, I mean, that's what line of sight is, isn't it?
Right, right, exactly.
You know, so, I mean, geez.
And the ultimate reason that I think I went with the way I did was I want the game to be fast-paced, fast-moving, and fun. And when you pile on rules and you just keep piling on, you know, Like he wanted, you know, different levels to train and levels to cover. And it's just like, oh, that's a lot to remember for people. You
know? Yeah, well, especially at a con. I mean, you've already taken a two-player game and accommodated it for a con where you could have a bunch of people playing. And you don't want to make it more complicated. You want to make it less complicated. So it'll move. Sounds like you did the right thing to me.
And I hope so. I hope so. You know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Time will tell as people play it. You know.
Well, I mean, you can always change anything you want, but I don't think his complaints were reasonable.
Right. You know, right.
I mean, that didn't make any sense.
And that's kind of to get back to your question is you'll get a lot of feedback. You get a lot of people telling you things, do this, do that. And at the time you may go, oh, that's a really cool idea. But when you go back and you look at what you've already written and the impact of even just minor changes on the whole system can be far reaching. The largest change I made to the game was rewriting the rapid fire table. I rewrote the table about halfway through the development process. And in hindsight, it was probably the best thing I did because I made it more favorable because it used to be really brutal. So people weren't using that system. So when I made it a 50-50, so that you had a 50-50 chance of having something good happen, then everybody used it. You know, when it got above that threshold of, you know, oh, I have less of a chance of having something good happen than bad, everybody was like, well, heck, yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to roll more, you know.
Yeah, I got a chance, so I'm taking it.
Exactly. I got that chance. Yeah. There's that chance, yeah. You know.
Yeah.
And the other thing, the one other thing I would say is give yourself plenty of time. Don't constrain yourself within unrealistic time frames and roadmaps. I originally, when I started, I said, I want to get this written in, you know, 4 months. And that was completely unreasonable. So I tried and I tried, and the stress of that was not worth the extra time it would take for me to finish the system. You know, give yourself plenty of time. When it's and you know, the old adage, when it's done, it's done. You know, you gotta take your time, do your play testing, get your feedback, review your feedback, keep doing play testing, and just take the time, make it right, you know.
Right. So. And on the other hand, it's never done. Yeah. Here you are, you're making another add-on.
So,
but you get it to a point where you like it and you're happy with it. And then you go from there.
Exactly. Exactly. And you write your supplements to add more things into it, you know.
So. Right. And then, you know, then you have the choice, you know, am I going to use the supplement in this particular scenario? And the bottom line is still the game needs to move along. Because if it doesn't,
if it doesn't,
then no one's going to have any fun. They're all going to be staring at the table.
Exactly. Exactly.
So how was Fallen? Did you have a good time?
Yes, I had a great time writing it. Like I said, it was stressful, but I was very happy when I finally printed a book and put it in front of me, and I was very happy to have my name and on that cover, and it just really was great, you know. And like I said, my wife helped me with the fluff. I had an old college friend of mine by the name of Bob Stearns. He did the cover as well as a couple of the other art pieces in the book, which I'll send you some links to his site that you can include in the show notes, Jonathan. I just got to give him a shout out because he did some fantastic artwork for me. You know,
you mentioned a point.
And then obviously.
No, I was just going to say, you mentioned a point system in, I was curious because I know point systems for a lot of people they're very divisive. Either they love them or they hate them. And I'm curious, is your point system mandatory? Or is there a mechanic or are people encouraged to use it or to not use it depending on their preference? Or like, how does that kind of play into the overarching role of the game?
Well, all the scenarios are written so that both sides would have an equal number of points. That said, when you're playing with your buddies, there's nothing saying you have to do that. Points really I use as a guideline of these are two equal forces. And by having the unit builder in there, that just gives people a guideline to put things that I haven't thought of into play into the same constraints as everybody else is playing, so that they're able to say, this is going to cost X points because it's got X abilities, and it's equal to what you're going to be fielding. I mean, there are games out there that don't have points that are completely scenario driven. But I really want, the reason why I used points was because I really wanted it to be, all right, you tell your buddy, all right, we're going to pay 1,000 points. And okay. And you look at your army list, you assemble your forces, you meet at the table, and you're generally in the same ballpark of, I'm not overpowered compared to you, though. In reality, whenever you go to war, someone has more power than the other guy. There's never a completely even matchup. But I strived for as even as possible.
Well, and it makes it easier.
So that's kind of why.
Too, like if you go to your friendly local game store and you're like, I got these armies. Anyone want to play a game? And someone who's never heard of your game before, it's like, that looks kind of cool. I'll try. They don't have to have anything. You have it just ready for a quick pickup game, and you're ready to go. You can spend a few hours playing and then be on your merry way.
Right, right, exactly. You know, and then it makes it easier when you're forces and putting things in play. It just, to me, it makes it easy to say, okay, here's the benchmark of where we're going to be as far as our armies are. You know.
Yeah, it's a good starting point anyway, and then you can just take it from wherever you want to go with it. Who knows where you're going with it next, right?
Exactly, exactly. And you know, there is a caveat in the army builder which says, you know, after you point up this guy, if you don't think it sounds right, adjust the points. You know, there's, because nothing is set in stone.
Right. So where are you running the game next to?
I have been running it at my local store, a new store that a few of my friends have opened up locally in Derry. It's kind of the home of Trilaterum. They actually have books on their shelves for sale. It's called Midgard Games. So I've been running games there. I will be at and Huzzah running games. I'm fortunately am not going to make it to Cold Wars. It's just timing is really rough, with PAX being the weekend before. After that, I'll probably be at Fallen. So, and the Hobby Bunker Games Day, as I always go there.
I'll see you down there. I'll be there for that.
Yeah, you usually do Huzzah and Havoc, so hopefully we'll see you at those.
Yeah, you will. I'll be at those. I should have already had my Havoc game stuff in yet, but I haven't decided what I wanted to do. Because they're open for registration right now.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they have been for quite a while.
It'll be Saturday morning is my game at Havoc. And Huzzah, they haven't opened up registration yet. So that'll be, you know, incoming.
I'm told it'll be soon.
Hopefully.
Nice.
Yeah, I saw your post on their forum. So hopefully, because I want to get my games, figure out where my game's going to get scheduled, then I can get my hotel room booked and all of that stuff. So
I still have to. We do a live recording at Huzzah. It's the MHWA is fantastic. They help to, and this will be an announcement which I'll be making in a couple minutes. But they help to support the show. They sponsor the show, and part of that is that I do a live recording at Huzzah, which is a lot of fun. I'll be doing it with one of my other co-hosts, Adrian Benson, because Mike's always busy running his game. And I realized I haven't, like, I have to submit a thing for it because it shows up in the book and everything. And I'm like, oh, it's just,
right.
Just put me in a room. And but like, they want to know, like, what time do you want to do it? And this and that. So like last year I was working with Dean Emerson, and I was like, Dean, do I really have to put something in? Can you just be like, hey, he's going to be here? He's like, no, you got to do it. And so this year I forgot all about it. And I think event submission's over, but I'm like, oh, I should talk to someone because, like,
for
I'll be there.
Huzzah?
I'll be doing it. Yeah, for Huzzah. Because I heard they're opening up.
I don't think I
heard they're opening up registrations, is what I was told. That's going to be coming up.
You can't even. They don't have event submission yet either.
That makes me feel so much better.
You should be good. Yeah, no, they haven't even done the events yet.
Because I was feeling behind the eight ball on that. I was like, oh, well.
You know, you got to get through the holidays and all that crap before you start doing it. You know what I mean? Those guys have lives.
Yeah.
You know,
my mind's already on TotalCon because we're in January, right? But TotalCon's
Right.
In February, and that's here before we know it. I'm like, okay, and I get all the stuff in for that because there's a lot of things I'm doing for that, co-running a game and you know, other events and stuff. And I'm like, but like I got to make sure like all that happens. Meanwhile, that comes, and then April's here before you know it for Havoc. And I mean, Havoc for me is easy because like Mike runs a game and you're running a game, but like I aim to go is always my plan. But it's for like one day. I just kind of go for the afternoon, hang out for a little bit, see some people, maybe do some shopping, and then I'm gone. And it makes it easy. It makes it cheap because I don't have to pay for anything. I'm in and out. And then May's here, and it's like, oh, it's time to go up to Maine because it'll be fun, and that's a weekend. But like that's like another big thing I got to think about, like all this stuff. And Maine is hard for me. Like Total Con, it's there's a lot going on, but it's not I don't have to bring as much stuff, even though I stay over. But for Maine, like I have to pack all this stuff for the show, and it's not a ton of stuff. But like I tell you, the first year that I packed a microphone, I packed it wrong and it got all scratched up. And I was like, oh, I need to do a better job. And then like it's a family vacation, which is great. We get to go and everything. But packing for a little one, that's a pain in the butt.
I'm glad I'm passing.
I got two kids, so I know what it's like.
Oh man, it's just so that's one. We have a great time, but I always dread like the whole like we got to get everything together. Did we forget something? And last year the little one was sick and her antibiotics were running out, so we're like, oh, do we need to like try to find a pharmacy to see if they can like set up another refill or like what do we do? And I tell you, it's wonderful when you can have a pharmacy that's all over the place because like life was great. And the location of Huzzah was fantastic because you're near the main mall and you're near everything. And it's wonderful. I can't recommend it enough.
Yeah, go over to Heidi's Deli and have lunch. That's a good place up there, too.
I know. And I liked last year they did the coupons for stuff. So, like, we went over and I tell you, they were fantastic. And again, not to keep harping on like whole family friendly kind of stuff, but we went over and that was just at the beginning of when my little one was starting to eat like real people food.
Right.
And we're like, so we're here for lunch from the convention. And we were talking and stuff and we're like, it's to eat. And what should we do? And they were wonderful. They walked us through all the options and everything. They specially catered stuff just for her. And they were fantastic.
Where was this?
Heidi's Deli or what is it? Heidi's Brooklyn Deli. Is that the name of it, Mike?
Yeah, I think that is the name of it. It's terrific. I'm looking forward to going there already.
It's in the plaza with the grocery store.
Yeah, check it out, Tim. We'll go over together.
Okay.
It's fantastic. You're going to love it. The sandwiches are great. Everything's like locally sourced and just really well done. And it's affordable too, which really surprised me because as soon as you start saying things like organic or locally sourced or whatever, I hear ka-ching, and they were very reasonably priced.
You get your money's worth. You're not going to be hungry after you get out of there.
Yeah, I mean, the food is fantastic.
Yeah, everything I had, I enjoyed.
Great. Actually,
locations. Actually, now that I'm looking at it, I thought it was just it, too. That's surprising.
Are we losing you?
No, I'm still here. You guys good?
Oh, okay. Yeah. I didn't hear anything for a second there.
Yeah, there was like a little glitch or something.
Oh, weird. Yep. Internet. I'm going to blame the snow. Because when in doubt.
Could be.
There you go.
Could be. Still coming down. But
Heidi's is a good thing.
I would blame this cat in my lap that's trying to get me to do something, but I don't think so.
Why don't we...
Luckily, all the cats ran away, so...
For listeners who want to keep up to date with all the stuff that you're working on, Timothy, why don't you tell us some of the websites they can go to or ways that they can keep in touch with you?
Sure. The website is www.trilaterum.com. That's TRILATERUM. That's the main website. And there's links there to go to my blog. My blog has most of the development notes, pictures, that sort of thing. The name of the blog is Oosel's Homeworld. There's a link right on my website to it. It's a really long blogspot name, so I won't torture your listeners with it. I also want to put a shout out to Midgard Games. They're the local game store that is the home of Trilaterum. They're the ones that have it in stock, and you can try a game out whenever I'm there. You could also, I also have a Facebook group, www.facebook.com/trilaterum. You can go there to find links to some of the Facebook Live videos I've done, as well as pictures and that sort of thing. It's also available as a ebook on DriveThruRPG. You can just search for Trilaterum on DriveThruRPG. A physical book, you need to go to trilaterum.com. There's a PayPal link there, and if you buy it, I'll ship it out to you ASAP. And there's also links to Stan Johansson Miniatures if you want the official miniatures for the game. They're at stanjohanssonminiatures.com. And yeah, that should be all the places. Lots of places.
It's good. I was very excited when I saw that you're on DriveThruRPG because we're also on there. The show's always free. But what I did, because I was, this was back before there were other options for funding kind of stuff, but I was like, if people want to like get it and they want to pay, why should I be like, no, don't pay? So I love that the whole drive-through family of sites, you have like War Game Vault and the card drive-through cards and so forth. They have that pay what you want option. So like some people, not for War Game Recon, but for like other products, because I know other game designers, they've done some pay what you want titles. And like some people will be like, here's $150 for your title. And some people will be like, I can afford a dollar. So here's your dollar or whatever. And but they're like, if they put it out, although before that they would have just been like, it'll be free or it'll be like $5 or whatever, and maybe someone will pay you $5 and maybe they won't. So it's kind of nice that you have these options, and I love their interface. So from like a back-end kind of point, I think it's great for a publisher like yourself to go, because you can get stats and kind of stuff, but then it's also really easy for a customer to go to DriveThruRPG or War Game Vault or wherever, and you have like that one login and it works for everything, and they keep all your downloads. So if your computer dies, you buy a new computer, you can print it out again. You can get it again. And,
oh, that's cool.
I didn't know you could do that. Funny, it's funny too, because I have quite a library on DriveThruRPG personally. And there's a lot of products that they don't even make anymore that they keep right in your library. Those downloads are still there for me to get if I want to. So it's kind of funny to see that. I have a lot of, just as a side note, I have quick reference sheets as well as army list downloads all available on the website. On DriveThruRPG, we have the book as well as a free download for the quick reference sheet. So if people want to just kind of see what the game's about, they can get the quick reference sheet and kind of see what it's about on there.
Oh, that's cool.
That is cool.
Yeah,
and that's the benefit of doing these online distribution, because if you had to make hard copies of that for people to try out, you'd be spending it a fortune in postage just to get it out to people. It'd be so, you couldn't do it. It'd be too prohibitive. So this way people can get a taste of it, and then they can be like, oh, I really like it. I'm going to go buy the digital copy, or I'm going to spend the money for a hard copy of the book, and then you'd mail it out to them or whatever. And it's nice that it's more accessible.
It is. And I'm kind of printing on demand in small batches, which makes it a lot easier on me because I didn't have to, you know, fork out for 300 copies right off of the bat. You know, it's something I'm doing in small 5 to 10 books at a very reasonable price locally.
You don't have to rent a warehouse to put them in or something.
No. Well, in the ebook it makes it super easy. I mean, they take a portion, obviously, as part of their fee, for especially for publishers, is very easy to use, very slick, and it was a breeze to set up and put it up for sale. So I can't say anything more better about DriveThruRPG, because they make it definitely easy for you to do.
Yeah. Their fee is low enough too that it's not a burden. It's like, oh, that's all they want. Okay, sure.
It's from a publisher's standpoint of I wrote this and obviously I want to make money on my product. You have to remember all of the things that they offer as the incentives to use their system, such as watermarking and the free distribution piece. It really does, like you said, the fee is not astronomical, and it really pays for all of the things you get out of it.
And speaking of paying for things, why don't we transition into what I like to call paying the bills, or our announcement section for the show? Because just like with your product, DriveThruRPG needs to pay the bills, and you also need to pay the bills and for the costs of producing and creating Trilaterum and the expansions and everything. It costs, I tell you, way back when I started the show over 10 years ago, I was like, okay, podcasting, it's this new thing, but what does it cost, right? You talk into your computer, and I tell you, it costs a lot, or it can. I mean, it doesn't have to, but it costs us a fair penny. I have some announcements, because these kind of helped you keep the show going. Because as you know, with a couple of kids, and Mike, you know, with kids cost money, and they eat it up really quickly. And that's something I've become more attuned to.
Yeah, so, and they don't care about it either.
Well, I tell you, like I used to, I would,
they don't have to, they don't have to care about it. That's awful.
I would fund the show completely. And then I was like, wait, money, what is that? I don't have any anymore. So I was like, we got to do something about this. And so the show is great because it is funded through a few different ways. One of which, and people heard at the beginning of the episode in the pre-roll, and they'll hear at the end, at the ending credits, the fact that we are sponsored by the Maine Historical Wargamers Association. And I'm very grateful to them for their sponsorship, and they help to keep the show running, and It makes a difference. And they do a lot of good in the world with a lot of other groups and helping kids and stuff. And so I am proud that we have this partnership with them. It makes a big difference. And we will be at Huzzah in 2017 doing a live recording, as I had said.
Just another reason for us to love those guys, which we already
They are fantastic.
Anyway.
You know, they sponsored the show the first year that they did it. And I was like, okay, this is great. And I truly thought, okay, they're not going to do it a second year, because not that it's like no money, but it's not a ton of money either, but it's still, for a group, it's a substantial amount of money. And I'm like, I hope they're getting a good return on their investment, because like I'm really trying, and I hope people will come in and stuff. And so when I went to vote at the annual membership for this time, and I heard that it passed, I was like, yay. And I was so excited, but I wasn't expecting it. But from what I understand, the guys, and I know there's some women, but I collectively refer to everyone as the guys, but the members really appreciated the production quality, in particular for the little ads that show up on the show for it, and they like the show. So I'm appreciative that people like what we do here, and that's what it really comes down to, because that's the other part of it. So it's kind of like the whole PBS model. So in addition to having a sponsor, which is great, something I know that's not always possible when you're doing game design, but it works for a podcast. But listeners help to keep the show afloat. So we use Patreon. Patreon's a great crowdfunding source. Think of it like a Kickstarter, but it's ongoing, so that it never ends for as long as people want to continue to back the show. And on Patreon, we are $22 away from our next goal. Reaching this goal will allow us to get equipment that we can use to record with people in person. So like at Havoc, at Huzzah, at TotalCon, can actually have, we could do this in person there. And right now, can't. We're all in different towns and across two different states. And I tell you, if you guys were literally living right next door to me on my street, I would have to be like, okay, you need to stay in your house, please, and get on your computer so we can do this, because like we couldn't sit around a table. And that is dumb. But hopefully by reaching this goal, should we be able to, we can do that, because I can then get equipment so we can then do it, and just makes for a better experience. And it makes for more fun, because when you do those kind of things in person, people then can come in person and listen. So like doing the live recording at Huzzah, it's kind of a weird jury rig kind of thing. And should people kind of come and see it? It ends up consisting of me being on one side of my MacBook Pro and Adrian being on the other with the mic in between. And we're like so close that if you came in and didn't know what was going on, you would think like, wait, what are those two guys doing? and like, really, because it looks odd. Like, we shouldn't have to do it that way. It's weird, but that's how it has to go. But it doesn't work. Like, if for me to have you, Timothy, over, and Mike, be over, like, we can't, like, all three crowd around the microphone and be like, hey, so what's going on? It doesn't work. So, like, we need
another. Yeah. So someday you'll be able to walk up to Tim's game while he's running the game and ask him a few questions, hopefully.
That's the
hope.
Yeah,
there you go.
Yeah, so that would be nice.
We're only $22 away. Awesome. And it's really easy to become a member. You in a backer, you go to wargamingrecon.com/Patreon. You can get in for as little as $1 a month. That's less than a cup of coffee. That gets you episodes before everyone else, and you get behind the scenes content. And then we have other backer levels, which are really cool. So one of the ones that I love, and this is why I actually really like physical product. So in as much as I love the ease and accessibility and the low cost of, say, getting like a digital copy of, say, Trilaterum, I really like having the physical so I can put it on my bookshelf, so I can have and refer to. And also because in this day and age, all the stuff I get in the mail are junk mail and bills, right? You don't get nice things. You don't mail letters anymore. So one of the things that I do is we have these cool Wargaming Recon postcards.
I got one of those.
You do? I know.
I do. Yeah, I like that.
And so if you back the show, it's $9 a month. Yes, it is $9 a month. Every month that you back at that level, you'll get one of these in the mail from me with a note, and I really fill it up. I try as much as I put a lot of stuff in it, talk about what's going on and new games I see and events I'm going to and stuff that makes me happy and things that you might be interested in and special deals or whatever, and I send that out. And then another cool level I have, and there are other levels that you can get t-shirts and so forth, but another cool level for $18 a month, you can get a set of 6 custom branded wooden Wargaming Recon dice. So these were made by Christopher Rennett, who's, I believe, an MHWA member. And these are just for 2017 for Patreon members, backers. So one of them says 2017 on it, and it says Wargaming Recon. And the other has a cool little hex and has the 17 in it. So if you back, you get a set of 6. It'll be half one design, half the other, and they get mailed out to you. So again, you get another cool thing in the mail. It's not a bill, not some junk mail, not someone saying, hey, you should switch from Verizon to Xfinity or from Xfinity to Comcast or from Comcast to Cox or whoever the other cable and phone people are. It's just like, here, use this, have fun. The nice dice, they roll well. It's locally made.
If you're a gamer, you need dice. You got to have them.
The more the merrier, right? We have one backer who's gotten a ton of these, and he just scooped up like a whole year's worth of them. And from what I understand, he loves them. And so that's an option.
That's cool.
And then you can also be thanked by name on the show. That's another level, and that's grouped in with other stuff. So, for example, I want to thank some of our Patreon backers. I want to thank Patrick, Chris Parker from DayOfBattleGames.com, Kyle from Vermont, and I want to remind you, you can become a backer. You could get thanked by name by going to WargamingRecon.com/Patreon. And then I just want to remind you of two other things. First of all, we have a lot of episodes that are going to be coming out this year. I think we do like 25 episodes a year. And you can find out what's going to be happening on those before it happens by going to our episode guide. So that's where you can look and you could see, like, if you looked, traveled back in time, you could be like, oh, wait, there's going to be episode 175 and Timothy's going to be coming on to talk about Trilaterum Games. That's in the episode guide. Or that we're going to be covering Huzzah in May and TotalCon in February and all these kind of things. That all goes there. It's a great way to kind of look into a crystal ball and see what's going to happen into the future. Just think of it as like a sci-fi power. You're able to kind of go in advance and see what's happening and pick what kind of episodes you want to listen to and see what are going to be going on. And I can actually tell you that the next episode that'll be coming out, episode 176, will release on February 13th, 2017. And I'm going to be reviewing the Cigar Box Battle gaming mats. And I'm hoping that our co-host Alex Christopoulos will be joining me. That's a plan anyway, but we'll see how life goes. And then I just want to let everyone know once again about something that's going on that sounds bad, but it's not. So we're the longest running tabletop wargaming podcast on the planet. And that means there's a lot of episodes that we put out. So many, in fact, that we've kind of clogged the pipes. And because of that, when you listen to the show, you listen usually, some people on the website, but you usually listen on a mobile device, you listen in a podcast app or something like that. Because there's so many, you can't get the new episodes. So what we had to do was we had to say, okay, hey, you're not going to be able to get them from beginning of time to now. You will get the 3 most current years of episodes. Automatically, they'll show up on your devices. You don't have to do anything special. You'll get them. If you want anything older than that, we tend to mention them on the show, and we'll be like, on episode 32, you should go and listen to whatever, and there'll be a link in the show notes. Otherwise, and he doesn't know this, and I mentioned this before we started recording, but I like to refer to him as our show notes monkey, but just because it makes me laugh, but I've been told it's not very flattering. So our audio technician, Joshua Shoebridge, down in Australia, he's a fantastic guy. I'm so grateful that he's part of our team here. He's going to be – he's the one who makes us sound good. So I guess I need to make him happy. I don't want him to make me sound bad. So
he's, yeah, I don't want to make him unhappy, that's for sure.
I know. Whenever I open my mouth, I'll just be like, and then everyone else will sound fantastic.
He'll straighten you out.
Yeah, I'll sound like a chipmunk or something. Don't get any ideas.
Nice.
So he's gonna be taking like an entire year's worth of episodes and then putting them together into a super episode and then releasing them so people can then download them from the website as like a zip file or whatever, and they'll show up in the feed. So that way you'll have 25 episodes. It'll be like 25 hours worth of content together. So it'll be all of like 2004. Here you go. And then sit down and listen to it all. And you'd have to be really bored, right, to listen to a whole year's worth of content.
I think I could, if I could set that up, like in the hobby room, would be something to listen to while I'm doing my stuff, you know?
I'm pretty sure you don't want to listen to the older episodes because I'm pretty sure I sound terrible. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I know, but
a classic episode from the vault. Please feel free to go and do
it. It'll just be something to poke you with, so I think I'm going to have to listen to those.
Well, there's a lot
of you're not going to get me not to listen to them now.
On the plus side,
not to say that.
You know, I'm going to get great stats from you doing that. So, hey, everyone, go listen to the old stuff, and they make fun of me because I'm okay with that. I will be the first to join in and be like, yeah, I'm such a goon.
It's all part of your sinister plan. I understand now.
There you go.
Oh, I will rule the world. Well, that's what we have for this episode. Yes, sir.
I'd like to put an offer out for your Patreon listeners.
Okay.
Anybody that is currently or a new Patreon listener for you, I will offer a $3 off the physical copy of Trilaterum. So I will give you a code that you can email your Patreon folks. And anybody that uses that code, I can't do it on the digital, but I'll do it on the physical copies. So if they want to send me an email with the code that you give them, they'll get $3 off a copy of the book.
Wow, thank you. That is very kind.
That's cool.
Hopefully you'll get some new Patreon subscribers out of it.
Well, that is further incentive for people to back the show. And of course, whether you back the show or not, I think you should just head on over to trilaterum.com, check out Timothy's game, and look at the free stuff. And then you got to decide for yourself. I mean, of course, listen to us. We're saying nice things about it. But you got to look for yourself and then just go and pick it up.
Sign up at one of the
cons. Still not sure, go to any of these conventions.
Check it out.
Play it again and again and buy at the convention, because then that will just say, hey, Tim, you should keep coming back to this convention because people love your game and they're going to keep on buying product.
Yes, so, please do.
it's a win-win. Well, thank you very much, Tim, for coming on the show. And
thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Oh, I'm glad you set me straight in that now I am more informed and better informed about what you're doing. And I love sci-fi. I play mostly historicals now, but like I grew up with sci-fi. I'm a huge Star Wars nerd. And so anything sci-fi related that has a good story is going to get me. And it sounds like this is a really interesting universe that I think I would like to inhabit. And so I'm just excited about it. And I hope other people are as well.
I can say Trilateral.
Great.
Now,
I hope so.
That's half the battle.
Well, you know, that was a real sticking point for me.
I tell you, when I first saw it, listen, I was like, how do I even say this thing? For some reason, I kept on wanting to say Trilaterium.
Well, I kept on meaning to ask Tim every time I saw him, and I never did. I don't know why. I just forgot, I guess.
I didn't to trip people up, so I apologize if it's tripping people up. So
no, but you know what? It's good.
Okay, we're working it out.
It stands out. It stands apart from a crowd. So it's memorable.
There you go. Yeah, that's what I
want. You need to be different because there's so much going on. So I think it's cool.
Right. Well, thank you, Mike, for once again being a co-host for the show. It's always a pleasure to have you on. And
yeah, I had a good time. It was good talking to Tim. It was fun.
Yes,
it was a good time. Definitely.
Thank you, everyone, for listening to this episode of Wargaming Recon. I want to remind you, like I did at the beginning of the episode, we covered a lot of stuff. I know it. But you'll be able to get links to all of the stuff that Timothy mentioned, Trilaterum and Midgard Games and Stan Johansson Miniatures and all that, plus everything else we covered. You'll have links to it all in the show notes that you can get by going to wargamingrecon.com/WR175. That's wargamingrecon.com/WR175. And until next time, you know the deal. No matter how busy you are in your life, no matter how long you're spending stargazing and thinking about fantastic science fiction games and weird races that have teddy bears as religious artifacts, you know you have to. You gotta. You need to keep up.